I want you to understand what symptoms mean and what they should tell you about your health and about your body. Learn how to read your symptoms. When you don't understand symptoms versus cause, symptoms versus problem, okay, then the headaches themselves become the problem. Say yes if you get that. So it all becomes, let's make the headache go away, all right? So of course the question is what can I do, what can I take to just make the symptom go away? Most people come in and they say, doc, I've got this going on. What do you think, should I take this? And I'm like, I don't know. Oh, is your objective that you want to live a longer, stronger, healthier life? You want to reduce your chance of having heart disease, heart attack, dying of a heart attack? You want to increase longevity? Is that what you're trying? The problem is very often drugs will work and they will quiet the symptom while you get sicker. So we need a better way. There's basically two major types of inflammation. There's acute inflammation, which is the swelling that most of us understand. You sprain your ankle, the soft tissue damage, there's basically a chemical reaction that happens in the body, and you swell, okay? That is innately appropriate. Now, the second type is what most people don't understand, and that is inflammation on a cellular level. It's an insidious, low-grade, chronic inflammation, silent inflammation. Chronic low-grade inflammation looks like this. Read this list now. Heart disease, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, strokes, mood disorders, depression, anxiety, brain degeneration, Alzheimer's, senility, obesity, diabetes, cancer, there's the trail, right? Joint pain, swelling, arthritis, atopic disorders, allergies, asthma, eczema, and acne, poor recovery and healing, and immune responses. Sound like anybody you know? I won't make you raise your hand or stand up and stomp your feet if it sounds like you. There's a life of probability, and there's a life of possibility. The life of probability is the one that if you just keep doing what you've been doing, you'll probably experience. And then there's a distinctly different experience out there, and that's a life of possibility. And that possibility, that life of possibility, is not the default mode. It's chosen. It's a decision. It doesn't happen passively. It's active. It's something that's chosen. So tonight, I'd like to suggest that we all get to choose. And one of the first steps that you can take in making that choice is making a commitment to living unconditionally.
Doing great, but either way, you guys are sure to get some great information tonight, okay? And some things to really boost that journey, okay? And take it to the next level. Before we begin, I just want to take care of a little bit of housekeeping and let you guys know some exciting things coming up, okay? So, whether you're a teacher, whether you're in the healthcare field, whether you're retired, it doesn't matter, just a pedestrian, being CPR certified is a really good thing to have. Okay, so what we're doing is we're setting up a CPR workshop to help you guys get certified in that. So if that's something that's something you're interested in, we can get you information on that a little bit. Okay, we want to make sure you guys are confident in those situations, right? Because it's going to benefit all those around you. Next thing, we've got Moms Tribe. Okay, so this is a time for moms to come together and to learn more about taking care of their kids, building the kids up, loving, serving, growing. All right, so we love our moms around here. We try to get you guys together and create some community around that. So Moms Tribe is going to be meeting Thursday, May 30th, if you guys are interested in that, okay? And then we've got our next Body Signals Workshop. All right, so I'm sure you guys know some people, or you yourselves have had some hip pain, some knee pain, some foot pain, something like that, right? So there's a lot of people out there who want to get help with that, okay? And so we're going to be offering a Body Signals Workshop on those conditions, and we're going to talk about some of the causes of those conditions and give you guys some practical tools to help you with that, okay? So let your friends know. It's free and all are invited. That's going to be happening Tuesday, June 4th. So I want to share a little bit about my story. I didn't know anything about chiropractic, but I was passionate about health. Okay, so I was a personal trainer for 3 years, and I was getting my degree in dietetics. I wanted to help people eat right, and I got a job in a hospital. Okay, so I had to do a 9-month internship for dietetics, and I needed some work experience, so I got in this hospital, and I found out that they were feeding post-op patients with heart surgery Salisbury steak with tons of gravy. And then I was making them a chocolate milkshake as a snack. And I just had a real conviction. I said, this isn't right. And so I worked there for about 3 weeks. And during that time, I met a friend of mine. He kept talking about this crazy chiropractor in the area and how much help he was getting from him. And I had a little bit of pain, neck pain, that was keeping me from doing some of the activities that I love to do, right? I was young, this was frustrating me. So I decided to go check this chiropractor out. And I got in there and found the cause of my problem. And he started educating me about the nervous system, about the way that the body's supposed to function. I started getting really excited, and I started working in the office. And I started seeing patients come in and get transformation and getting off of drugs, right? Getting off allergy medications and things like that. Then I started doing my own research. And I started reading patient testimonials and research about infants getting help with things like constipation. And I was sold. I was like, I want to be in health and fitness, and I want to be a health coach the rest of my life. And chiropractic is the realm to do that. We are on the cutting edge of healthcare and in research and coaching people unto greater health. Okay, so I'm really excited you guys are here. I met Dr. Steven 2 years ago during my chiropractic schooling, and I knew at that instant I found my coach. I wanted someone to help me through school and keep my mind right, and to coach me through that. And so I'm a man of faith. I started praying about who that would be, and this man, he lit me up. When you talk about a wellness lifestyle, the way that you move, the way that you eat, the way that you think, things that I was passionate about, he's a master in. And so I knew I wanted to learn from the best. And so close to graduation, I applied to be able to work in this office and work with this master. And so, thank the Lord, I was selected to work here. And so this man, the clinic director in this office, Dr. Stephen Franson, he is my coach, my personal coach. He is always in the research. So the information that he's going to be bringing tonight is cutting edge. I'm so excited that you guys are here. Again, it doesn't matter where you're at in your health journey. Tonight, take something home with you, okay? Take notes. If you guys have paper and pen, take notes. So right before I bring him up, I want to share a testimony with you. This is a patient in the office, and she wrote this. When I first came to Franson Family Chiropractic last spring, my spine was a mess. I was being treated for several chronic immune system conditions and taking a half a dozen medications. So in short, I was in miserable shape. After just several months of care, I saw improvements in my spine, my gastrointestinal health, and lower back pain. Now that I've been receiving adjustments, making major diet and lifestyle changes, and following Dr. Steve's recommendations for nearly a year, I have turned another corner. I've completely stopped taking all asthma medications and my asthma has disappeared. Additionally, for the first time since the mid-80s, I am no longer suffering from seasonal allergies, and I'm getting nor am I getting migraines from perfumes. In all my 36 years, I cannot remember ever feeling as good as I do now. I'm so grateful for the entire Friends and Family Chiropractic team. So what we have to offer you guys tonight, this information and this clinic, is really powerful. It's transforming people's lives. And at the head of that ship, giving us direction and training us and showing us how to educate, is Dr. Stephen Franson. So please welcome me in joining him as he brings this wonderful information tonight.
Dr. Mark, congratulations for joining our team. How's everybody doing?
Awesome.
Where's my clicker?
On the spot.
On the sushi bar.
The healthy spot.
Welcome everybody. I know almost all of you.
Hi, how are you?
Good. So I want to just welcome everybody, and I want to first recognize you for always making this time and your health a priority. Right? We have a busy world now, yeah? Pretty crazy busy, yeah. Well, I respect this time a great deal. We invest a lot of time in our education with our patients, so I just love it when patients take advantage of what we offer here. As Dr. Mark said, our purpose is to educate and adjust as many families as possible back towards optimal health through natural chiropractic. Yeah, that's the purpose of this place, and we really try to live that purpose every day. So tonight we're talking about the body signals of around atopic disorders, and we'll unpack that a little bit tonight. We're going to talk about allergies, we're going to talk about asthma, we're going to talk about eczema, and you know, we're going to dig deeper a little bit in the immune system. Now, this is one of my favorite topics to speak about because, I'll be honest with you, this is my own personal chiropractic miracle. So when I first discovered chiropractic care, when I first found chiropractic care, I was actually full-on engaged in the medical route. I was studying, I wanted to become an orthopedic surgeon. That was my deal. I was at the University of Vermont, just geared towards a sports medicine approach towards health and wellness. I knew I wanted to do something that helped people get stronger and healthier, and I was very, very passionate and still am about everything to do with health and wellness, fitness, nutrition, headspace, etc. And that was just the road and track that I was on. I was fortunate enough to be an athlete in college, right up until the point where I damaged my shoulder, destroyed my shoulder, and missed my senior year. In that process of damaging my shoulder at the school that is, it's the top sports medicine school in the country, which means in the world, I had a lot of people working with me and trying to help me. And at the end of the day, after about 9 months, they said, okay, so you're all done. No more sports, no more working out, no more surfing. And to me, at 19 years old, I had lost 30 pounds of muscle. I had just lost my identity. I'd lost myself. And I was just so distraught by it. And they said, it's time for surgery and trying to pack it in. So my dad was seeing a chiropractor in Boston. And when I came home for Christmas break, he said, okay, that's it. I'm tired of hearing about it and hearing you moping around the house. You're going to come see my chiropractor. And I was like, rolling my eyes. And I'm like, all right, I've seen everybody else. I might as well. And, no offense. We hear that quite a bit from you guys. It's like, well, we've been everywhere else. We might as well give you guys a try. I'm like, I'm sure there's a compliment in there somewhere. It's like, no, it's okay. We're thick skinned. You got to have titanium skin to be a chiropractor, as you can imagine. So this poor guy, he had to put up with me because I was the educated skeptic, So I'm standing there like, when he was telling me what was going on with me. And he kept talking about my spine and my neck and my upper back. And I'm like, dude, I have a shoulder problem. Are you not listening to me? And the whole time I was like, I've already been taught that you guys can't help me, chiropractor. So he put up with me long enough to help me. And he corrected the problems that he found in my neck and my upper back, and he helped me understand the relationship between those structures and the nerve supply and the tissues that were bothering me. And actually, he started to teach me really about how the body really functions and how the body really heals. And I just really started to just listen to this guy only because his results were speaking for him. And I was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe the results I'm getting here in the short amount of time. And I loved his approach. And I loved his passion. And I loved that he loved his job and he loved his work. And I was just like looking for an adult male who was excited about what he did every day. And this guy was like the personification of that, right? The embodiment of just passion about what he did. And then he blew it because he told me, you know, that neck issue is related to those sinus problems you were telling me about too, and those allergies that you have. Because I started getting these wicked allergies that were getting worse. My 1920 just started getting worse on me, right? And I'm like, okay, so you just lost me again. You know, so what did my neck have to do with my allergies and what have you? So I'll tell you the truth story in this is that not only did I get my shoulder back, but when my neck was corrected, my allergies were gone. And it's extraordinary, and I couldn't explain it at the time, but I can explain it now, and I'll try to explain it to you guys tonight. You ready for that?
Yes.
Okay, very good. All right, so tonight, the atopic syndromes, this is a word that may be new to you, atopic syndromes that we're going to be unpacking here are the most common ones that we see in the office. Allergies, asthma, eczema, okay? So those pretty much cover a very broad spectrum. We cannot totally unpack this concept, and we cannot fully unpack all of these concepts here tonight, all right? That's not my objective here tonight. So we have 30 minutes together. So in 30 minutes, I'm gonna give you a lot of information. I like to say that I talk fast, so listen fast, all right? I am not trying to do an exhaustive discussion on each one of these topics, but rather I want you to walk away with what I call whack. Walk around knowledge or walk away knowledge. You should know what you should be doing and what you should do differently. And really, I want you to grasp an overriding narrative of understanding what's at the root cause of all of this stuff and what you can do to really make some big changes. We always start here with body signals description. So what is body signals? Where does that terminology come from? Body signals are what we call symptoms. Okay, that's how we refer to symptoms in our office because we recognize that the body's innately intelligent. Say yes if you believe that. Okay? So the body signals your symptoms is the way one of the ways your body communicates with you. All right. So if our body is smart and it's trying to talk to us, we should respect and listen to our symptoms, right? And it's one of our criteria, so to speak, is paying attention to what's going on with the body's symptomatology. That being said, the symptoms are body signals. They're a symptom or a sign that there is a bigger underlying problem. Say yes if you understand that. All right. They are not the problem in itself. You have a headache. The problem's not the headache. You know, you take an aspirin or a drug to make the headache go away. Why did you have a headache is a better question, right? So, you know, it wasn't an aspirin deficiency, right? So when we look at the way people are managing their health today or treating their symptoms, you know, what we're seeing is this just culture of pharmaceutical use, over-the-counter or prescription pharmaceuticals, where we've created this culture where people are just simply treating their symptoms and managing their sickness and disease. And frankly, that's not good enough. So when we look at this body signals graphic, I like to use this iceberg because you've got the classic surface with the iceberg, what you see above the surface relative to the 90% that's below the surface, right? Perfect metaphor for symptomatology, right? Because if you looked at this, you'd recognize that, you know, if you were in a boat on the surface, you'd be like, oh my gosh, look at that huge iceberg, right? You'd be aware of that, but you wouldn't be aware of what's going on underneath. And we know what part sunk the Titanic, right? So if we were to approach this from a medical reductionistic perspective, and we came along, we cleaved the top off of that and successfully removed the top of that iceberg, just imagine that would be possible, right? And we couldn't see the iceberg anyway, and we came back 90 days later, what would we see?
The iceberg.
The iceberg again, right? And what would happen? This would be bigger down below, okay? So this is what happens, is we treat symptoms until we can't see the symptoms or feel the symptoms, and then the problem gets bigger over time. And typically that means that we're drugging away our issues, so to speak, or drugging away our symptoms, and the problem just gets bigger and bigger over time. We need a better way. So I like to teach the wellness-illness continuum. All right, so imagine that here is a continuum. Zero is neutral. This far right-hand side is perfect optimal health and function, and the far left-hand side here is death. Everybody get that? All right? All of you fall on this continuum somewhere. All right? And there is no stasis. You have to understand that. None of you are static. You're either moving towards health or you're moving towards sickness. Say yes if you understand that. Okay? You're either moving towards health and getting healthier or you're moving away from health and getting sicker. All right? So what we do in our office is first try to assess and find out where do you land on this continuum and give you strategies and recommendations that move everybody in this direction. Simple enough? Okay? Well, let me point out one more thing. Symptoms. If you listen to symptoms and you learn to speak body, your symptoms will tell you about the direction that you're heading in and also tell you about your trajectory and your velocity, etc. All right, so understand this. When your symptoms go up, it means that your inflammation went up. And when your symptoms go down, it means that your inflammation's gone down. Make sense? So we start to speak body and we start to speak symptomatology. And you understand that, hey, when my symptoms went up, my inflammation went up, what did I do recently? What behaviors led to the increase in inflammation? Now you're becoming fluent in body. And conversely, when symptoms go down and you understand that that means inflammation's gone down, you could say, well, what did I do? What strategies did I employ that helped me drive my inflammation down? Simple, okay? So you pay attention to symptoms and it tells you about trending and direction. So ground rules, number one, you were designed to be healthy. Say yes if you believe that.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You would think, well, operating in the modern world and listening to popular media, that you were actually designed to be sick, right? To be almost predisposed. Oh, you get the gene for this, you get the gene for that. I'm predisposed. It runs in my family, you know? It's incredible how often people just come to me and they just say, hey, this runs in my family, right? Oh, a heart disease runs in my family. The person's talking to me is 85 pounds overweight. I'm like, no, the problem is no one runs in your family. You gotta understand that there's a lifestyle here that's manifesting this. How many generations did we go back? You know, 2-3 generations? You know, for 3,700 generations, we've successfully avoided chronic diseases, you know, but the last 3-4 generations, we are, you know, a disaster, yes? Okay, so we are designed to be healthy, and for 99.6% of us, we have the genome that's designed to be perfectly healthy if it's given the right opportunity, the right environment over time. Number two, your husbands are not in the room, so you can say amen, you are intelligent. All right, amen. All right, so we are intelligent, and you should know and you should understand that there's an intelligence that runs your body. Okay, it runs every cell and every tissue and every organ system of your body. It's the intelligence that was there when a sperm bumped into an egg and you were taking the SAT 17 years later. It's very powerful stuff, okay? It's in every single cell of your body. It's what got you up today. It'll put you down tonight. It's digesting your lunch right now, sending the essential fatty acids where you need them and all the essential amino acids where you need them. How smart are you? So the body is intelligent, okay? Is the body smart or stupid, guys?
Smart,
okay? The body is smart. You would never know it the way we behave, okay? You would never know it. The way we are so confidently manipulating our body's chemistry, popping pills and doing things, taking parts out of the body, just you would think that the body was stupid and it needed our help to survive till tomorrow, right? So we're going to examine that. The body's intelligent. Your nervous system is the master system. You know, it's extraordinary to me. I take care of a lot of kids and I take care of a lot of teachers and we have this conversation. Most kids, including most of us kids, could trace a drop of blood through the entire body and tell you all the organs and everything that they did, right? You can trace that blood. Most people can't even tell you the parts of the nervous system, okay? So we're gonna talk a little bit about that tonight. So your nervous system is the master system of your body. I always ask the kids, what's the most important organ in your body?
The brain.
Yeah, you guys know. It's a loaded question, right? The brain. What do you think most kids say?
The heart.
What do you think most adults say?
The heart.
What do you think most adult men say? All right, everybody says the heart, the heart, the heart, the heart, right? Come on, girls. So the heart is not the most important. They're doing heart transplants, aren't they? Yeah, I don't know a lot of people that are getting brain transplants. I know some people that should be on the list, but the brain is the most important organ, and the nervous system is your master system. You'll learn tonight why your spine is your lifeline. Okay, so we're in a chiropractic office, if you guys didn't notice. So we're definitely going to help you understand and appreciate the relationship between your spine, your nervous system, your immune system, and these atopic disorders. And my favorite rule: if you keep doing what you've been doing, you will keep getting what you've been getting. So let me say this. If you come tonight and you find this interesting and entertaining, you had a great time, wow, that was fantastic, very interesting, but you don't change your behaviors, I have failed you, okay? So I don't just love to hear myself speak. I do like to hear myself speak, but I don't come here just to hear myself speak, all right? So I'm not home having dinner with my children tonight so I can be here with you. Say yes if you get that, all right? So I'm gonna ask you, you owe me. I want you to change some behavior starting tonight, okay? It has nothing to do with you, Bessie. It's just that I'm lactose intolerant. All right, so let's talk about the immune system. What is its purpose? And again, I'm running and gunning here tonight, all right, so bear with me. All right, so your immune system works intimately with your nervous system to essentially help you relate to your internal and external environment, okay? There is a very complex symphony that's going on all the time that's protecting us and helping us adapt readily and appropriately to our environmental shifts and changes. Do you guys get that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So think of like your immune system as your armed forces. So what do we have in the armed forces? The Army, the Marines, the Navy, the Coast Guard, right, the Air Force, right? So we have these these huge bodies of specialists that operate on different levels to what? Protect us, right? And to protect liberty and all of our ideals and everything that we believe, right? And help people in need. This is what the armed forces do and the armed services do for us, right? This is what your immune system does. Your nervous system, it acts as the communication network for all of that. Say yes if you guys get that, all right? So you can't separate the nervous system and the immune system. Right, so they work intimately together, just like you can't separate the digestive system from the nervous system. Yes? Okay? So its purpose is to protect you and help you relate to your environment. So how does it work? Essentially, there are chemical, reflexive, neurological components to this, but essentially your body is always on alert looking for invaders. If there's something that's inside your body that's not supposed to be inside your body has a whole cascade of chemical and neurological responses and reactions to that. Usually, works along beautifully. You have no idea it's even happening. Whether we're fighting off a bacterial infection or a viral infection, or we're just responding appropriately to pollen or pet dander or you know, tick mites or whatever it happens to be in our environment. You know, or we're fighting off cancer in any moment. At all moments. You guys know that all times you're constantly fighting, identifying cancerous cells and killing them. That's immune system, okay? So you have a magnificent system that is totally subconscious most of the time, that you have no idea what's going on, but you are constantly at war, but it's really you're in harmony with your environment. So yes, if you get that, the difference there, okay? So that's how it works essentially. How does it develop? You're gonna understand the immune system a little bit better if I use sort of real-time developmental issues. So this next slide, what I've taught this material in the past, and sometimes people come to me and go, well, I blew it. I blew it with myself, and I blew it with my kids. I don't want you to think that way, okay? But if I don't teach you this, I can't sleep at night, all right? Because when people use the word prevention, I want to go, you know, because for most people, they have no idea what prevention is. Like, you notice that the medical world sort of grabbed that word prevention and taken it, you know? It's like a colonoscopy is prevention, prostate exam, mammograms are prevention. Are those prevention?
Detection.
It's early detection, which leads to what? Early intervention. Right? Cutting skin moles off is not prevention. It's early detection and early intervention. Prevention would be, you know, wearing sunblock and long white shirts and wide-brim hats and staying out of the sun between 11 and 2 like your ancestor did. That's prevention, okay? So let me teach you how magnificent you are and how your body has been designed through the eons and continues to develop this immune system. And there's a legacy that passes from generation to generation as our immune systems actually get smarter and mothers pass on to their children. Okay, it's extraordinary. So natural development. So how are things naturally supposed to develop? So we are born genetically pre-programmed physiologically with a lot of our immune system intact, okay? But then there's a process of development that furthers our immune system. It's a lot like training, like in the armed forces. So you take a kid out of high school, right? You throw him or her in boot camp, and what do they do first? They learn how to run, you know, they do physical training. They get them physically equipped, right? And then what do? They learn hand-to-hand combat, right? And then they give them knives, and then they give them sticks, and then they give them handguns and rifles and machine guns and bigger toys, right? So it's all part of a training process. You become more and more specialized. Can you imagine if they just took a kid out of high school and threw him on the front line and bypassed all the training, okay? This is what we're doing to our children today. And I'll help you understand how we're doing that. So here's the boot camp that we go through as babies. So in a natural vaginal delivery, it's messy. Anybody ever been there? Yeah? Okay? So it's a magnificent, awesome thing, but it's messy, okay? When it's done in a natural setting, all right? It's a very messy thing. Do you know that when can I be discussing here for a minute? You guys, will you bear with me?
Okay.
You know, so essentially what happens when a child is delivered, they're exposed to the mother's normal flora. Guess where most of your normal flora lives? In the reproductive tract and in your digestive tract, right? So a woman will actually expose her child to, it's not a bowel movement, but it's normal flora from the rectum. So when the child's delivered in a natural environment, it's messy, it's dirty, it's part of that exposure that starts to build the normal flora. So your normal flora is your friendly bacterial flora that is inside of all of your mucosal linings, all your digestive system, reproductive tract, etc. Anything that's exposed to the outside world, including the insides of your GI tract, which is actually exposed to the outside world. If I took this and swallowed it, whatever's on here, it is exposed inside my body, right? So So your gut is lined with friendly bacteria. You have more bacterial cells in your gut than you have in all of your cells in your body. Over 150 trillion friendly bacteria that are in your gut, that are part of your immune system and help you digest, etc. Do you guys get this? That starts in a natural vaginal delivery.
Okay.
We go from that to breastfeeding. So most of the constituents of breast milk beyond just nutrition and energy is the immune system components. Okay? There's a massive body of research that's come out now that helps us understand how magnificent this system is. Do you know that a woman can actually communicate with her child through the nipple as to what the child needs to respond for the immune system, for the immune function? So a child will actually communicate to a mother through their saliva, through the nipple, and the mom will change her breast milk day to day based on the needs of the child. Everything from nutrition to the immune system. How brilliant are you guys? Okay, how incredibly sophisticated is that system, right? So unfortunately, instead of a year or 2 years of breastfeeding, most children that we're seeing today are a couple of weeks, maybe several months on the long end. Okay, so we're missing out on so much of this development. Childhood illnesses, let's talk about this one. So a child will go through this regular process of exposure, right? So as if you pay attention to raising a child, everybody's been around little ones and little babies, and one thing you'll find quite commonly is they'll get the sniffles, or they'll get mucus, or they're running a fever, or they'll get the ears fired up, or eye infections and all this sort of thing, right? So here's the story. That's by design. Okay, so just like that boot camp and that basic training that those soldiers go through, the design of this body, and I believe in a brilliant designer, the design of this body is to take this baby in a safe environment, okay, and expose it in a very limited way, first off of mom's breast, mom's chest, to the bedroom, to the house, to the siblings, then to the yard, and then to school, etc., right? So there's this ever-expanding concentric ring of exposure, right? So the child gets exposed to indigenous bacteria and viruses and other antigens that they will come across. All of this stimulates the immune system and teaches it how to respond appropriately and readily to anything that's getting in the body. Do you guys get that? This is heavy, complex physiology, but I just want to make sure that you guys get that, all right? So what's the body to do, all right? So let's watch a baby, put him down on the ground. If I had this on the ground and there was a baby in the room, where would the baby head? Right to this, okay? And what would they do with it? Crawl up to this thing and right in the mouth, right? So do we sit there and go, a stupid baby, you know? We don't. We recognize that the body is what? Brilliant. Okay, so what is the baby doing? All right, so babies will pick things up. First thing they do is put it in their mouth, right? So what's the design here? As kids are starting to break teeth through, and their gums are all open because the teeth are coming through, that's a portal of entry to bacteria. So the child will reflexively take everything and put it in its mouth so the bacteria can get into its bloodstream so it can mount an appropriate immune response. So it's training the immune system to respond properly. Make sense? Pretty awesome, okay? So what happens? Kid gets feverish and mucus and etc. So what do we need to do? Run off to the pediatrician and slam them with antibiotics? I mean, what are we doing? All right. So why is it that every time a child spikes a fever, what's the first thing that people want to do? Drug them and bring it down. So what's the purpose of a fever? Who can tell me? What's a fever for?
To make an inhospitable environment.
Wow. Okay, that was better than my answer. Inhospitable environment for a germ. Okay, all right. So our body has figured out and learned, and by design, it knows that it can heat itself up and kill off the germs, okay, and save the child, all right? So what's the first thing that most parents want to do when a child runs a fever? Bring down the fever. Does that make any sense? Let's bring down the fever by giving it a drug, and then we'll give it an antibiotic. All right, so what are we doing there? I've asked that question to 1,000 moms, and 1,000 out of 1,000 times they say, oh yeah, fever is the body's response to an infection. So the body will fight off an infection so it'll kill the bacteria and the baby will live. Okay, you're pretty smart. So what do you do when that happens? Well, bring down fever. What do you do? Well, you're supposed to. According to whom? The ad on television? All right. Who can tell me, what's a high fever? Yeah. You're not allowed to give any more answers.
For a child?
You guys are advanced. What do you think?
I'm thinking more of 3 for, but I don't know about kids.
What do you think?
I mean, I would be upset at 102, but I know that I'm in the 1s.
I got upset at 105.
I love that.
I didn't get dressed.
Well, you guys are like superheroes, okay? So usually I are like, oh, they ran 101, 102 fever, and I'm you know, I've been there. I'm not mocking anybody. I'm daddy first, then doctor. All right, I've held my babies at 105, 106. I know what that's like. And it's always on the road, always in a hotel, always like, really? Like now, tonight, right? So the, if you look at the CDC rating, if you talk to immunologists and you look for the ratings for fever, up to 102.9 is a low fever. 103 to 104.9 is a moderate fever. 105 and above is a high fever. Makes everybody relax. And a high fever is not a bad fever, it's a high fever. So you have to manage it responsibly. The point I'm trying to make is recognizing that there's a real intelligence running this body, and it's magnificent. And if you read the research, it'll calm you down because you recognize that the body really knows what it's doing. Right? Now, are there times for intervention? Absolutely. At the rate that we're doing it now? Absolutely not. So what are we seeing with unnatural development? You know, C-section, sometimes. So is that absolutely necessary sometimes? Absolutely. Absolutely. 37% of the births in the country last year? Absolutely not. Is like 94% vaginal delivery in Brazil, Russia. Formula fed, so we're skipping breastfeeding altogether, right? And this is, I think this is reaching a crisis level right now. It's tragic, although I'm seeing breastfeeding really making a comeback, which is just so greatly important. I tell moms this is like one of the most important things you can ever do, and it's almost a full-time job, so it requires all the deserves all the credit in the world. But this is one of the greatest things you'll ever do for your child. Interference, medications. We're running interference in all these systems. These systems are brilliant, and they're designed to help the child develop an immune system. And we're interfering it, whether it's an antibiotic or it's trying to bring down a fever. We are interfering in the child's training process to develop their immune system. I just read some research that shows there's a huge correlation in asthma rates now, if you have a child that's had antibiotics at under 1 year of in their first year of life. Huge correlation. And then vaccination. All right, so let's talk about this one. So vaccination is a question that I get constantly. And what I want you to understand is that there are some philosophical positions on this, but I'm going to come at it tonight from an immune system perspective, okay? So at the end of the day, what the experts will agree on, and people don't disagree with this, is we have ultimately traded short-term acute natural childhood illnesses through infection for chronic disease. For long-term chronic diseases like asthma, allergies, atopic disorders, right? So because we are foregoing these natural processes like chickenpox, how many in the room had chickenpox? Okay, so now everyone's inoculated against chickenpox. Right? So this is what we're seeing is there's a massive shift in trend in the amount of vaccines that these children are receiving. Personally, I view that as an insult on the immune system and on the nerve system, especially when you start stacking them. Right? Especially at that age of life. If you talk to most pediatricians, ask them what kind of schedule they do because they understand that that's an early insult, especially when they start stacking and combining. But when I was a sixth grader, if I was on schedule, I'd have 18 shots, right? Today, a sixth grade is what? 73. Okay? What direction are we going in, right? And if you chart that, you chart that against asthma and allergies, this is what you see. And the track runs exactly the same. Essentially what we're doing is we're trading off acute illness, childhood illnesses, for a lifetime of chronic disease. You guys understand that? Okay. So that's my argument when it comes to that, and we should at least be having that conversation. All right, so the hygiene hypotheses. Understand this, is that there's an interaction, the consensus in the literature with the experts is there's an interaction between the host and the environment. Okay, so the genetics and the lifestyle and the environment that the genetics are kept in over time. Okay, you guys get that, all right? And what they're seeing is they are downgrading and downgrading and downgrading the genetic influence on it, because what's happening is the frequency or the rates of the trending of these atopic disorders are going through the roof, and they just recognize that the gene's not changing, okay? So what we're seeing is that they're understanding now that it's literally the lifestyle choices and the behaviors that are playing the biggest role here, right? So I find the hygiene hypotheses to be one of the most fascinating and compelling arguments. And what we're seeing now is because we are seeing so much of this type of behavior going on, okay? We're gonna look back and laugh at this. Just so you know, we're gonna laugh cry about this, because you watch these kids nowadays, they're raised on this, and this is part of their culture, okay? So they think that this is This is like the shield of protection around them. They think that this is where their immune system is, okay? You guys see that, right, in this next generation. They are looking for this, and they want this at every turn. So, you know, what we're seeing is essentially there's such a sensitivity around hygiene, and really it's a sterilization of our environments, that we are reducing the natural exposure to the design. Okay? We are raising our children in too clean of an environment, so their immune systems never get challenged and they never get a chance to get trained and work out. Okay? So ultimately we end up with these weakened immune systems, these compromised immune systems, totally terrifically untrained and unsophisticated immune systems. These kids are hyperprotected, so they become hypersensitive because they're not exposed to the usual bacteria and viruses and the antigens that they would typically get exposed to in nature. And they know this to be true because they see trends with, you know, kids in farms. There's, you know, very few allergies and asthma and atopic disorders with kids because they're around animals all the time. They're outside in the dirt all the time. You know, they see a huge reduction in atopic disorders with multiple families. So the more kids you have, the fewer asthma allergy cases you see because you're obviously exposing each other. And they find that you see more allergy and asthma with more affluent families. Because they have cleaner homes, cleaner environments, they're more likely to medicate, more likely to vaccinate, more likely to age figure in every step of the way, as opposed to the kids who are just exposed. So we need to look into this. So I call these atopic disorders a behavioral problem. You know, have you ever heard the expression like when your stomach's acting up? Okay, everybody has kids, right? So you know what a behavioral problem is with a kid, right? So when you look at a behavioral problem with a kid, you say, well, what's causing it? Is it ever just one thing? Right? All relationships, right? They're mosaics. It's a symphony of a bunch of things. There's a lot of elements, you know. We have to look at every situation and be like, well, what's creating this behavioral problem, so to speak, with this child? All right? There are factors that come into play. It's always multifaceted. Almost always multifaceted, right? If somebody has a digestive issue, same thing. This is usually multifaceted, the things that are going on here, right? Well, it's the same thing here when it comes to allergies, asthma, eczema, any of these atopic disorders. This is a behavioral issue. What's happening is your constitution globally is misbehaving. Your immune system is misbehaving. Essentially, it's oversensitive. It's hypersensitive or hyperallergenic, genetic. And we are misbehaving, so to speak, in its response to antigens. So I'm going to use this analogy. Right? Props, I feel like a magician holding this down here. Okay, so this is the way I wanted you to think of yourselves. You're one of these three glasses, right? So I want you to think about this water level representing sort of the threshold of tolerance for you. Okay? So some of you walk around and you're near empty glass or totally empty glass. Okay? Some of you, your glass is half full. Some of your glass is half empty. All right. So this is some of you. You're walking around with a half full glass, and this again represents your tolerance, your threshold of tolerance. And then some of you are walking around and you are just brimming to the top, right? So some of you are just like just cresting over the top, but we have like surface tension on you, right? So essentially, this is your immune system, and it's sort of preoccupation, or it's loaded state, if you will, ready to spring into action. Does this make sense to you? All right. And then what happens is we walk into a room where there was, you know, a dog, you know, in the room, or pollen, you know, drops out of the sky, right? Or we climb under our bed to dust, all right? And your cup spilleth over, okay? So this is essentially the response that we're seeing with people. Because all of these elements, dander, dust mites, any type of toxin like nicotine or cigarette smoke or pollen, you know, for any of you who suffer from hay fever, these are all stimulants. These are things that create this stimulation of this immune system and create a response and a reaction from your body. The question is it an appropriate response? You have a huge tolerance where you can walk right in that room and there's no problem. You know, the pollen's flying, doesn't matter. You still have an immune response, but your body on a cellular level is responding to that, but you are subclinical. Okay, there's no clinical response. Some people will say, "Oh yeah, well I'm allergic to dairy, you know, like that cow joke." Okay, so I have some level of intolerance, right? So you're not lactose intolerant necessarily, or you're just more so intolerant than the rest of us. We all have some level of immune response when you drink cow's milk, And so all of us will have a measurable immune response. It's just some of us are subclinical and some of us are clinical. In other words, our cup spilleth over. Does this make sense to you? Okay. So the question you should ask yourself is, well, how do I become this cup that's empty so I have a greater tolerance for this? So I used to be like this, and now I'm like this. So everything that I do, everything that I teach, the way I live my life is to how to make sure that I'm not this person walking around here, that I'm walking around here, and I'm able to just adapt and readily respond appropriately and readily to stimulants in my environment. Make sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? All right, good. Is everybody thirsty now? All right, so what are some of these stressors? Stressors, toxins, and you know, we talk about air pollutants, you obviously cigarette smoke is a big one, et cetera. That's an example of a toxin. Allergens, we talked about hay fever. Anybody here suffering with seasonal allergies? Okay, this is a big one. I hear this quite a bit right now. So essentially, you're the person that, you know, this time of the year, the pollen gets released, and you know, the eyes are itching, you're swelling, your sinuses are running, and they come in and like, oh, dog, it's the ragweed. And I'm just like, look, if ragweed caused allergies, we'd all have allergies, right? We're all exposed to it. The question is why are you spilling over, right? Dietary, so for a lot of people, you have a very pro-inflammatory diet style. Now, there are some food sensitivities, fish and eggs and milk for some people, and those are, you know, those are real extreme food sensitivities that may give that whole overt response, right? But what we see is most people are living their lives in a way that they're eating regularly and they're filling that glass right up. Okay, they're pro-inflammatory. Things like white flour and white sugar, the refined carbohydrates, right, the white death stuff, all right? Also the dairy, these are all mucus builders. These are the things that will predispose and fill that glass up, all right? And then there's the neurological component. So this is one thing I want to talk to you guys about here tonight, is understanding the neurological component of this sensitivity and what creates that cup to be so full. So chiropractic 101, for most of you don't understand how the nervous system works, but in short, the brain is constantly communicating with all the tissues, organs, and organ systems of the body, and all that communication happens across the spinal cord and the nervous system. Okay? The body talks to the brain, tells it what it needs. The brain tells the body what to do. There's a two-way communication happening there. If that communication is running optimally and flowing across that nervous system without any interference, you respond appropriately and readily to your environment and you express health. Easy enough? Okay? That spinal cord is protected by the spinal column. The spinal column is this awesome, sophisticated structure. It's this series of bones stacked up on top of each other, 24 vertebrae, that form a suit of armor to protect that spinal cord. We know, we said, the brain is the most important organ in the body. We know this because it's encased in bone, right? So does the skull. Well, the spinal column protects the spinal cord, which is simply a continuation of the brain. So here's the brainstem comes through this foramen magnum with this big hole at the base of the skull. And if you stack the vertebrae up on top of each other and you look at a bird's eye view, it forms a tube of bone, right? And that tube has the spinal cord inside of it. Now, it's not just a solid piece of bone because there are discs between each one of these 24 vertebrae that create a space to let these nerve roots come out of your spine. These nerve roots come out of holes called the vertebral foramina. Those nerve roots branch off and they become your nervous system. So these nerve holes are critically important because you want to make sure that these nerves are able to breathe and not be irritated or choked off at all, so that the information that keeps you healthy and healing is flowing without any interference. Make sense? So in order for those nerves to be nice and big and open, the discs need to be healthy. The discs need to be big and fat and parallel, big spaces that leave plenty of room for these nerve roots to exit. Okay? Now, in order for those discs to stay healthy, these curves have to stay healthy. So your discs are not shock absorbers in your spine. Some people are taught that your discs are shock absorbers. They're really not. Curves in your spine of the shock absorbers. See, the spine looking straight away from the back of the front should be straight up and down because straight is strong. But when you look at the spine from the side, there's this really cool set of curvatures that acts as a spring that flex and forgive as you walk and run and carry. These curves are critically important because they will take the forces of the spine, not the discs. And as long as the spine looks like that, and those discs are nice and healthy, and there's plenty of room for those nerve roots to exit the spine and feed your tissues, there's a flow of information that keeps you healthy and healing. Okay, everybody get that? Now, as long as that's the situation, your body's expressing its optimal health and function. Now, in life, we have traumas and we have bad habits. Nobody in this room, but we have some traumas mixed in the group, right? So when a joint gets jarred out of a healthy position, either through trauma or through bad habit, it creates stress on the disc, and that creates soft tissue damage, much like if you sprain your ankle. When your tissue swells, it crowds that very delicate nerve fiber that's trying to leave the spine at that joint level, and it changes the information that keeps you healthy and healing and helps your body regulate all its systems, including your immune system. Okay? Now, when subluxation occurs, the joint gets jarred out of alignment, it damages the soft tissue of the disc, that creates swelling, the swelling creates nerve pressure, that creates muscle spasticity because your body's smart and it's trying to split the joint. Okay? And that muscle spasm creates joint fixation. Joint fixation leads to breakdown and degeneration. And then when you have that nerve irritation, the way your body responds to any irritation or stress is it produces stress hormones like cortisol. Okay, and the catecholamines like epinephrine and norepinephrine. And one thing that stress hormones do is they downregulate your immune system, or they change or they alter the normal function of your immune system. So when you're subluxated, when that spine is out of a healthy position and it stresses the nervous system, it's screwing up the communication system in the armed forces. Okay, you got to understand that, and it changes the, or what's called modulates the immune response. It changes the immune system and the way the immune system functions. Pretty easy, right? So let's talk about allergies. So when we check people, when we check their spine, what do we see commonly? So these are the things that typically we see from a segmental level. When you look at the spine, C1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that's the cervical spine. And then this T1 through 12, that's the thoracic spine or mid-back. And then you have L1 through 5, that's the lumbar spine. So typically when somebody comes in with allergies, especially seasonal allergies or sinus problems, they have a problem either at the base of the cervical spine, up here at the base of the neck. Everybody reach back and grab that big point at the back of your neck. You feel that big one right underneath the skull right there? It's more fun if you reach over and grab somebody else, especially if you don't know them. Just grab them. Okay, we're very handsy in the inner. All right, that's the C2, okay? So your brain stem is right in there. Also, we see C6 and C7. Now, I would love to say it's so simple that it's just a cookie cutter recipe, and we check a spine and we say, oh, you got sinus problems? It must be a C6 or C7 problem. But what I can tell you is millions and millions and millions of cases show us clinically that there's a correlation. Okay, so I usually say, I like to bet dollars to donuts that that's probably where your problem is, C6 and C7. Okay, make sense? And this creates a chemical problem because it controls the part of your body that produces histamine. Okay, does everybody know what an antihistamine is? Okay. So histamine creates an immune response. So it's part of the immune response. It's associated with inflammation and mucus production, all right? So a side note, for people who have dietary issues like dehydration, diet, you know, what you drink is part of your diet style. A lot of people are walking around chronically dehydrated. So water is one of your most important antihistamines. It's one of the most effective antihistamines, which is what you always hear us talking for many reasons, that people need to increase their water intake. All right, so allergy problems, C2 or C6 to C7. Asthma. Anybody notice the trending that we're seeing with asthmatic kids? So do you remember when we were kids, remember like the one kid in class that had asthma, like the one kid that had the inhaler, right? I don't know about you guys, but you spend any time around kids now, and it's just like they're pulling them out, you know, here's my iPod and here's my inhaler, you know, and they come out, it's just like, it's like car keys for kids now, you know, it's like, oh, I got my puffer, called the puffer. So I mean, the seasonal allergy induced asthmatic. I've got the sports induced asthmatic for patients. I had an 11-year-old that came in there, and they had stress induced asthma, and I'm like, "You're 11." Right? I'm like, "What are we doing? What are we doing to these kids?" Right? So you see this puffer taking. Massachusetts brags that it has one of the highest percentage of children who. So, all right, so asthma, what we see typically, what correlates clinically is C1 and C2, T5 through T9 in the thoracic spine, and S2 to S4. So C1, C2, this is the atlas axis up top. This is, again, brainstem. This is like mission control, right? You can tie back almost most visceral problems may have an upper cervical origin. T5 to T9, this is related to the adrenals, and S2 to S4. Very often with little ones, you'll see this associated with their bowels, okay? And you'll see an immune response related to, associated with poor bowel tone and constipation. All right, so again, same thing with eczema. If you've never seen it before, this is a pretty mild presentation, but we're seeing more and more about with this atopic disorder with kids. just they're essentially their immune system misbehaving. You see this sort of outbreak in these patches. So eczema will typically see thyroid-related issues, C6 to T3. Adrenals, again, T9 to T12, and then S1 to 3, again, that's bowel tone. So a lot of this is what happens is the kids' bowels aren't working properly, so then they get backed up when they're constipated. Toxicity dumps back into the bloodstream, and they recycle that, and they end up actually just an eruption, you know, through the skin. So we see a lot of kids get a lot of help when we clear up that bowel and get the bowels moving properly. Parents bring them in for constipation, the next thing you know, they're like, oh my gosh, their eczema is clearing up. They're not making that constitutional, you know, connection. Okay, so what causes subluxation? Life, guys, these are the bad habits. I mean, everybody gets the fact that it's car accidents and, you know, sports injuries and slips and falls and that kind of thing, but this is much more common. So we have this terrifically unnatural lifestyle now, and this is, you can probably see your life here, right? So these postural toxicities, these are the things that create that misalignment, and that postural deformity will lead to that stress in that nervous system. And this is what we do. We correct subluxation in this office. So this is what we call the three-legged stool of healing. The three-legged stool to get the best results is you get your adjustments, chiropractic adjustments, in rhythm. Chiropractic adjustments in rhythm so that you get that spine trained back into a healthy position, stabilize the problem, stop the damage, let the swelling go down so the body can heal and the nerves can breathe. We teach you the bad habits that you have that are creating your subluxation pattern. Our goal is that you get healthy, not that we just adjust you and you go back and you live an unhealthy life and we go back and forth, three steps forward, you know, three steps back. And then exercises to strengthen. We teach you specific exercises that you need to do to strengthen the spine so that you'll hold the adjustments better. Okay. Now, we have five objective criteria for how to find subluxation to see if the root cause of your problems is nerve pressure. Number one, we use an instrument that helps us find inflammation. We do motion palpation as the joint's out of alignment, swollen, and won't move properly. Okay, so we can feel that with our hands. All joints should move through a natural range of motion. Static palpation, you can feel actually inflammation, feels like a bruise on an apple. That's what we're poking when you feel us poking your spine when you're checking your spine. We're looking for that edema. X-ray, of course, we take x-rays of the spine so we can see exactly what's going on and how to help you. And then visualization, this is one of the coolest ones. It's a very simple examination. It's called a biostructural exam. We do a postural evaluation and a bilateral weight scale study. In short, we've agreed that the body is smart, right? So in a natural, healthy state, the body's balanced. Make sense? Okay. Now your head should be balanced over your shoulders balanced over the pelvis, spine should be straight up and down. All right. Now if your body senses any nerve irritation, it simply just leans away from it. Functionally, what it's trying to do is open up the joints so the nerve can breathe. So that creates two things that we can measure: postural shifts and deviation away from normal, okay, and the difference in how you carry your weight and a balance. Make sense? All right. So this is called a postural evaluation, all right, or bilateral weight scale study, and then we call it a biostructural exam. So for anybody who would like to get checked tonight, I would encourage you to do that. All right? So if you've never had your spine checked, this is a very quick and easy but powerful examination that allows us to sort of eavesdrop on your nervous system to see what's going on, to check you for indicators of nerve irritation. Okay? Piece of cake. All right. Atopic disorders are a behavioral problem. It's a mosaic, multifaceted issue. We learned a lot here tonight. As you can see, it's very complex to be a healthy human being. You've got to have good strategies. Do what you would do in nature. Always question, what would be the best thing for me to do here? Well, say, what would I do in nature? And that will take you down the right path. Okay? All of us need a good health coach to keep us on track. We'd love to be a health coach for you. If you want to get your spine checked, one of these fine doctors are going to be sticking around. If anybody has any questions for me, I'm going to stick around. I promise you guys I can stick around for Q&A. So I just have 32 minutes. So come on. Helpful?
Inside.